Number 2. Tim Curry initially voiced the Joker but had to step down due to bronchitis after recording 4 episodes. The role was then taken up by Mark Hamill, and Curry still receiving credits in a couple of episodes under different character names. Let's check out some of the differences real quick.
Batman, you stink so bad, I can smell you from here. Pew. Pew, pew, pew.
The Joker's nuts.
I don't know that we really knew what we wanted the Joker to be, other than we didn't want it to be a Jack Nicholson impersonation.
Justice is served hot, Batman. You're gonna melt just like a grilled cheese sandwich.
He was Joker-like, terrifying, and lock up the children and don't let them watch.
Oh, that's a joke, right? Batman finally told a joke. Oh.
Tim was just like a little bit like a horror movie.
Just for that, Batman.
In the end, the attempt to make the show appear a little bit less scary probably had more to do with why Tim Curry was removed. He claims it had to do with his bronchitis, but they may have found out that Mark Hamill was a little bit better voice actor, even though they did sound quite similar, as we can see in the next clip.
From here! Pew! Pew, pew, pew! Justice is served hot, Batman! You're going to melt just like a grilled cheese sandwich! Justice is served hot, Batman! You're gonna melt just like a grilled cheese sandwich! Service with a smile? Service with a smile.
Number 3. Censorship rules led to the decision to age up Dick Grayson, aka Robin, in the series to avoid depicting the endangerment of children. Number 4. Two-Face's character was meticulously developed, showing Harvey Dent in several episodes before his transformation into Two-Face. This approach aimed to shock the audience with its dramatic transformation, and it definitely worked. He was great in the cartoon, as well as in Nolan's Batman movies. Two-Face was pretty cool in those ones as well, in my opinion. Let me know what you think in the comments. Number 5. Kevin Conroy was chosen as the voice of Batman after an audition that involved over 150 actors. Have any of you ever competed for a job with that many people? It's pretty intense. His portrayal of Batman has become iconic in various media, especially the cartoon. Some people consider Conroy the best Batman.
I am vengeance. I am the night. I am Batman.
Number 6. The show intentionally omitted displaying its title because Batman was such a recognizable character that viewers across different languages could instantly identify the show's theme. Number 7. The voice acting for the series was unique in that it was performed ensemble style, with all actors recording their lines together in the same room, except for Mark Hamill, who stood while voicing the Joker for added energy. Number 8. Characters like Renee Montoya and Harley Quinn were created for the animated series and later integrated into the Batman comic books. And don't let anyone tell you otherwise. Harley Quinn comes from the cartoon originally. Number 9. Besides the introduction of Harley Quinn, the series introduced several other elements into the regular Batman comic continuity, including an origin story for Mr. Freeze. This story is quite compelling and will really tug at your heartstrings, so I decided to include all of it here. It's about 4 minutes long.
Rest well, my love. The monster who took you from me will soon learn that revenge is a dish best served cold.
I am recording what I pray will be mankind's first step toward immortality. Behind me you see the CC-100, a cryogenic freezing chamber of my own design. I created it for the express purpose of freezing subjects stricken with inoperable ailments. Subjects like my own beloved wife, Nora. Once a remedy has been found...
Open this door! Open it now! Get away from that equipment. Shut this stuff down.
Stop!
This is my experiment.
Your unauthorized experiment. I ordered funding suspended weeks ago. I'm already $3 million in debt, thanks to you.
You can't stop it now. My wife is in there.
So bring her out.
You can't interrupt the process now.
Open it.
It's her only chance.
This is my equipment. Mine. I have every legal right to use it or not use it as I see fit. I say this project ends now.
No! Stay away from her. Murderer.
Victor. I'm sorry. I lost my temper. It doesn't have to come to this. We can talk.
Oh. Oh!
Get out! Get out!
Nora! Nora!
My God. Yes. It would move me to tears if I still had tears to shed. Tonight I mean to pay back the man who ruined my life. Our lives.
Even if you have to kill everyone in the building to do it?
Think of it, Batman. To never again walk on a summer's day with a hot wind in your face and a warm hand to hold. Oh yes, I'd kill for that. I failed you. I wish there were another way for me to say it. But I cannot. I can only beg your forgiveness and pray you
hear instead of traditional white, saving time and enhancing the Dark Deco art style. Number 11. One of the other reasons Tim Curry's voice was replaced as the Joker was because he sounded a little bit too much like his other character, Captain Hook. Number 12. The series holds the record for the most spin-offs of any animated television show, including Batman, Mask of the Phantasm, Superman, the animated series, and many others. DC definitely knows how to make animated movies. It's unfortunate that they can't really do live-action movies as well as we would like, although some of them have turned out pretty good. Number 13. The Scarecrow's voice actor, Henry Pollack II, had to change his voice due to throat issues during Season 1, affecting his portrayal of the character. Seems like this is unfortunately a common theme. I just mentioned in one of my other videos that the voice actor for Marge had to do the same thing on The Simpsons. Number 14. Commissioner James Gordon and Alfred Pennyworth never exchange a word throughout the entire series. Number 15. Harley Quinn's creation was a last-minute addition to an episode in place of the Joker's original disguise as a female model, but not a hand model. That honor goes to David Duchovny's character in the movie Zoolander. I also think Joey and Friends did some hand modeling for a minute, if I remember right. Number 18. The series borrowed several elements from Tim Burton's Batman movies, including character names, designs, and the city's aesthetics. Number 19. Fox insisted on featuring Robin prominently in every episode. They were worried kids wouldn't watch a show unless kids were in it. This is why the name of the show was changed to The Adventures of Batman and Robin after the first season. They actually moved it to the primetime slot in Sunday evenings. Unfortunately, it wasn't so successful, and it only stayed there for a few months before it was removed again. But the first episode to air on primetime was I Am the Knight on December 13th, 1992. But later it was taken out of primetime and moved over to the WB, where most people remember watching the show. Number 21, Mark Hamill auditioned for the role of the Joker despite concerns about his Star Wars persona, and his unique laugh played a significant role in landing the part. That laugh works too, like it's definitely menacing, and people remember it. Yeah. Number 22, the rarely seen pilot promo reel, The Dark Knight's First Night, was introduced in the DVD box set years ago, although its original audio track was lost and then replaced. Well, the audio was replaced with the theme song that we're more familiar with. Fortunately, in the modern era, we have the internet, so we can pull it up and check it out. Unfortunately, I can't post the video here because YouTube will hit me with that copyright strike, even though the video is clearly already available on YouTube, so I recommend checking it out. It's pretty interesting. Number 23. Many people are aware that Fox was kind of fooled into doing the Batman cartoon. They thought it was going to be more child-based and not so mature, although of course all of us young kids, we still loved it, but Fox didn't want that initially. So instead, after the show was already produced and they got over their anger, they just imposed an incredible amount of rules, like no blood, no gun violence, which is easier with Batman, I suppose, although there are guns in the cartoon from time to time. We just saw some. And then no child endangerment, which makes sense. That's why we mentioned earlier that they aged up Robin. And then, but that caused a lot of conflict between the people making the show and the people who were paying for it. So there was quite a lot of problems there. But you know, it still worked out in the end. It's just the show got moved around a lot to different time slots, but it just still remained incredibly popular with fans. Number 24, the show featured notable voice cameos from well-known celebrities such as Ron Perlman, Heather Locklear, and John Rhys-Davies. Surprisingly among these, United States Senator Patrick Leahy also made contributions. A devoted comic book enthusiast, the senator served as the U.S. Senator for Vermont for years, and he not only lent his voice to an episode of Batman, specifically Season 4, Episode 2, titled Showdown, but he also made cameo appearances in 5 live-action Batman films: Batman Forever, Batman and Robin, The Dark Knight, The Dark Knight Rises, and Batman v Superman, Dawn of Justice. This guy might be in more Batman movies than Batman. Number 25, Fox's demand for Robin's inclusion interrupted a number of potential interesting stories featuring Catwoman and Black Canary teaming up and kicking butt. Number 26, the series reimagined Clayface as an actor, departing from the original comic book character's background as a treasure hunter. Number 27, Michael Ansara, who voiced Mr. Freeze, delivered the iconic line, "Revenge is a dish best served cold," a reference to his role as a Klingon in Star Trek. He played the character Kang on such series as the original Star Trek in 1966, in Deep Space Nine in the 90s, and Star Trek Voyager a little bit later in the 90s. In summation, thanks for joining us in the shadowy alleys of Gotham, where we don't mention that one thing about Batman's parents. If you have any more super secrets or anecdotes behind this timeless classic, be sure to share them in the comments. As we conclude our journey through the animated world of Batman and his most notorious foe, the Joker, we thank you for joining us. And stay tuned for more adventures in the world of nerddom and nostalgia that you'll only find here on Chrononaut.